know me from the political world or from Channel 2, but I joined on with the Greater Buffalo Sports and Entertainment Complex and was recently named the president and CEO because I believe about this project. We are building for a better Western New York, and anything that can bring 10 to 15,000 jobs to this region is something I am wholeheartedly for. The gentlemen that will be speaking to you are internationally renowned for creating sports and entertainment districts. And from that, my friends in Indianapolis can attest, they have rebuilt the entire region. So
we've been receiving a lot of support over the past few months. And one of the things that we recently received in support of this initiative is a letter and spiritual support as well as political support from Reverend Al Sharpton. Now, primarily, that information was filtered to the National Action Network through their local chapter, which is represented here by Pastor Greg Nelson. They share with us, and I know they share with everyone in this audience, a desire to create meaningful jobs now for people that have been unemployed for far too long.
The National Action Network is about inclusion, economic empowerment, and about equality. When we think about this project, when we think about this vision, this opportunity for Buffalo, I think all those things come into play. So as the president of the Buffalo Niagara Falls National Action Network and the spokesperson for Dr. Sharpton, I want this group to know that we are in full support of this project.
These gentlemen that will be addressing you today, we have Randy, John, and Mark. These are all principals of HGAS, and they have built sports and entertainment districts right here in the U.S. of A., and their company has been all around the world. So without further ado.
So the nice thing about these multi-purpose stadia is they serve as a catalyst for the regeneration of areas that are parking lots or need regeneration. So planning destination environments is what it's all about, and I'll ask my colleague Mark to speak a little bit about a few of the destination environments.
I saw just a very appropriate image. It was on the back wall of the elevator, and it was Buffalo in 1901, beautiful picture of Main Street, and it had the trolley system that cost a nickel at that point. That was a huge project for the city. And I sat there and I thought a lot about what we're going to show you today. And I thought about things like connecting people and connecting assets and connecting to the central business district and connecting to the water. And that's exactly what we're going to show you today. And I think that's really what that trolley did. It allowed people to go up and down Main Street, maybe get to destinations that they hadn't been able to get to before, or even better yet, today's world, experience things like they hadn't experienced before. So this is an example of Indianapolis, where the state and the city came to us and they were concerned about the RCA Dome and building a new facility for the Colts, and we immediately broadened that picture out, and we started talking about things like connecting the Central Business District to this portion of downtown. We talked about things like having a Super Bowl in the city. And I think if any of you watched the Super Bowl, probably the most successful Super Bowl to date was in Indianapolis. And a lot of it was because of that early planning and that early thinking and how to connect the different assets and the different pieces to the city. And that's a lot of, again, what we want to talk about today. This is a shot of Lucas Oil Stadium in Indianapolis. And very successful multi-purpose venue. Anytime we do a building like this today, we talk about multiple event days, multiple tenants, multiple things that can happen in these type of buildings. As I move into Cowboys, which you've all probably heard about or seen or maybe even listened to Mr. Jones talk about, they're very complicated buildings, probably some of the most complicated buildings on the planet, because a lot of things happen in there in a very short time frame. So you think of tens of thousands, in this case 100,000 people showing up in a 3 or 4 hour window to go to an event. They all have to be brought in, brought through security, fed, restrooms, toilets, and that type of thing. So they're very, very complicated buildings. We have totally changed the NCAA Final Four. We went in, it's one of the most popular events in the world, as you know, and we went in and said, you know, why don't we use these large buildings, get everybody to have optimum sidelines, and have 60, 70,000 people watch the Final Four, instead of using half a building, putting up a big black curtain, and having 30,000 people use the building. So we're now, when you watch the Final Four every year, that's a little bit of HKS working with those large venues to reconfigure the Final Four so that it really is a premium environment for everybody to watch the Final Four. And then finally, concerts. You know, big acts like U2, the Eagles here. I don't think the Eagles are going away, and I don't think U2 is going away, and they need to play in large buildings like this. So we think about them and accommodate the needs for those. Because it's, you know, the reality is it, you can't tell from what I'm talking about. It's a very competitive market, and whether you're a college football entity, or you're the Final Four, or you're a lacrosse, U.S. lacrosse organization trying to figure out which building to play in, it's very competitive, and they look at the building. So it's important what we do up front to make the building as multi-purpose as possible. Today is really about Buffalo and an incredible site. And if you think about the connection to the Central Business District, you think about the connection to the water, I can tell you, and Randy can attest to this much more stronger than I can, there are cities that are dying to have that connection to the water, if they have water or not, and connection to the Central Business District. So that's what's exciting to us, and Randy's going to get into much more of the detail of this incredible site.
It's my job here today to try and take some of these ideas that we've seen and see if we can connect them to what it would really be like here in Buffalo. And let me just start by saying that for us, urban design and putting a plan together like this is a big economic development piece. And we've heard a lot about what happens inside these buildings, but what's really going to create value is the sense of place that we can make there. And Hutch has alluded to, if you build it, they will come. And so I'd like to show you a way that we're starting to think of an idea to make a framework in order to enact that to happen and let this building catalyze the future. And in order to think about Buffalo, you need to know what other cities are doing. And this is something we're all doing together in Oakland. In Oakland, they have three professional sports venues, baseball, football, and basketball, all playing on the same site. It's a 1,000-acre site, even larger than your outer harbor. And it's in an area where there's a lot of transportation, an undiscovered waterfront, a lot of the sports venues, and the necessity to park 10,000 cars. So we were able to put a connection to transit, creation of new waterfront, rebuild infrastructure, and put it together in a new way that would rename the identity of Oakland. New York City on the west side, and famously known for Hudson Yards, was not only a sports and entertainment district, but a big commercial center, really the third business district in Manhattan. And it was so powerful to have sports and convention in the middle of the third entertainment district and commercial district. It included expansion of the subway system, connections by rail back to Penn Station, new parks, and about 30 million square feet of office. This is an appropriately scaled New York City project, and we'd be thinking the same way here for Buffalo. Famously, if you know the story, the Jets ended up not going here, and now the most sought after real estate in the island of Manhattan is the place where the stadium was. So the purpose of a master plan is to create real estate that's so valuable that it works for any land use. This is Miami, and you know this because the Heat just won the NBA championship here. And this is also a sports and entertainment district. And the ingredients here were not only an arena, but a 35-acre park, a new home for the Miami Art Museum, the Miami Museum of Science, and 2,000 residential units, 1,000 of them market rate, 1,000 of them subsidized. It's become the best new economic development generator in the city of Miami, and all started with Mickey Arison and the investment of the Miami Heat. And then we've been talking a little bit about Minneapolis, and this is one that we're doing right now. Interestingly here, for this stadium, we need to use the same ingredients, park 8,000 cars. They have a light rail system in Minneapolis like you do. They've got the need for people to gather, and so we took the parking requirement, the light rail requirement, and the need for people to gather and said, if we were a developer, what would we like that place to be like? So we turned it towards an economic development scenario and created a big park, improvements to the transportation system, relied on the parking needs for other development to supply what the team needed. So there's no parking dominating the environment. The light rail is deeply embedded in the middle of the plan. And as Hutch said, the developers are now acting even more quickly than the Sports Authority. And so what does it all mean for Buffalo? And when, for us, when we talk about waterfronts, it starts with the water. And you've got, as soon as we take this out, we look at it, an amazing body of water here. You got rivers, shipping canals, coves, piers, and if you count them all up, there are actually 11 different kinds of water located here on this waterfront. And they promote all kinds of uses out on the water, from active windsurfing to parking of boats to docks and harbors to settings for ecological basins. And what hasn't happened here is any real landslide development like you see in other cities, like the use of piers in New York, or the creation of sports in Chicago, or uses of the river for nighttime entertainment in Milwaukee, or the grand promenade in Philadelphia when you finally make it to the river. So the water is a big, powerful idea here. The second big, powerful idea is, how do we do a grand park on the Great Lake? And for us, it's about using the water infrastructure and the park infrastructure to drive an idea. So what you're seeing here on the bottom is your Outer Harbor, and on the top part of this slide is Chicago's Grand Park. These two drawings are at exactly the same scale. So you can see the size of what the park is like in Chicago. And this is the impact, the economic development impact that that park has had. So for us, open space isn't only a cost, but it's an important value generator. And Chicago would not be Chicago if it did not have this Great Park as its front door for the city. Your Outer Harbor would be the new front door for your city as well. And it's a home for their museums, and it's a home for their stadiums, and it's a home for their convention center, and it's the great frontage that all the developers want to be on in the city. When you get right down to it, one issue with this Outer Harbor is that it's really hard to get to, and you know as you drive around, and one way is you can get there on the Skyway, but the highway is not the right way. If you're a downtown person, you really have to be able to get out to a place by streets, and you have to drive all the way around, take a few minutes out of your life, 3.5 miles. A lot of cities have been confronting this issue head on. Take Pittsburgh, for example, that has located its sports and entertainment district across the river, intimately close to downtown, within a quarter of a mile. People walk there, people drive there. And when they started putting their sports and entertainment district together, it feels intimately connected now to their downtown. This is what we think is the great opportunity for this district, that it feels part of downtown. That is not only a sports stadium that's part of downtown, but the entire Outer Harbor feels very close to the best part of your city. And that includes parks, it includes the transportation system. And if you were to kind of diagram Buffalo, you look at it today, and your four most important streets make it to the Buffalo River, and then they start to peter out a little bit. And really, the city ends at the Buffalo River. But the notion is to take those streets, and not rely on skyways and highways, but to take those streets and use the river to your advantage and engage it the way that a lot of other cities around the world love their rivers, bridge them, and incorporate them into the environment. So by a very short distance, those four streets can make it all the way to the water. You've heard Mark talk about connecting to the water and downtown. And you do it by building infrastructure, and you do it by using streets. That's the classic method in most cities. And when you do that, you start to get a framework for development. And a framework for development then is reinforced by the extension of those streets, an open space system that reinforces all the waterways that we saw there, those 11 bodies of water, each uniquely giving an idea about various land uses that go upland, and it becomes a place that's not just simply about a stadium or just about a convention center, but it's really a place that's about the waterfront. That would be the theme and what the spirit of the place wants to be. And when you zoom in and you start to look at the ingredients, you see that there's certainly room for stadiums and convention centers and even a winter garden as part of some magnificent structure that might be the postcard icon of the place. Certainly an opportunity for a new North American Museum of Sports and Culture that could sit on the park, not unlike what we're doing in Miami. Kelly Island all of a sudden opens up as a great opportunity, and there would no longer be a gap in excitement and energy between downtown and the waterfront, and then even on the left-hand side, the piers start to produce a different kind of an environment. You might ask, because it's a magnificent and a large vision, almost like Chicago, and Chicago's taken 100 years to build what they've done, but Chicago has felt complete for 98 of those 100 years. You break a big project down into small pieces, so let's take Main Street and the light rail, for example. Just a simple extension of that with a light rail park, if you want to call it that, at the foot of a stadium, at the foot of a convention center, starts to be one of the first moves. So now we've introduced infrastructure, we've introduced open space, we've introduced some development. And then over time, incrementally, as the project starts to pay for itself, we add to that infrastructure and the place grows. But it doesn't grow in an engineering manner, it grows in a more spiritual manner about what it's like to engage the waterfront. So now Kelly Island is starting to become more developed, and then eventually over time, the park begins to complete itself. So you need a magnificent park vision, but it's going to be more than anybody could afford in the early days. So the park grows over time, the development opportunities grow over time, and the infrastructure grows over time. And when I work with these fellas, I tend not to show images of stadiums, but images like this. Here's what the future of Kelly Island and the river could be as a nighttime entertainment district that is catalyzed by the stadium. But now you're starting to see the engagement of bridges, you're starting to see outdoor areas, maybe the incorporation of some of the grain silos that are still there, and plenty of new development opportunities. And then the last image when you step back, which is the establishment of a great waterfront place with a stadium as a centerpiece, a museum, a park system that weaves seamlessly through, a waterfront that's reinforced, that takes advantage of the second biggest boating region in America outside of South Florida, streets that connect back to downtown, and ultimately downtown would grow. So in a nutshell, this is our idea. This isn't our only plan idea, but these are the ingredients that you need to think of and that we tend to think of when we're putting together a stadium and a larger economic development plan.
I think you understand the importance of not 8 or 10 events a year, but 150 events, 125 events. I think they had 143 event days last year in Indianapolis. When you have something generating that many event days, especially if you talk about the dynamic of having a 250,000 square foot convention center as a part of that, suddenly your event days grow exponentially, and as a result, economic development, your development teams, developers want to be a part of that. And I think this Outer Harbor site offers a lot of opportunity in that regard, and we thank you for your participation.
To say up front that we're all aware of parking, infrastructure, roadway, light rail, environmental and economic challenges of any site, but those are issues that are addressed very much in detail. Once we have a land option, that will be our responsibility as developers.
Part of the reason why we love that site is exactly what you talked about, and we believe that all the things that you just mentioned can happen and even be elevated with the development around it. So people can go there, enjoy the water, not feel like they're, you know, getting pinched out of the space. We can take that up to an even higher level and increase that experience.
Homestead's vision, that framework for neighborhood parks and connected by great streets, you really see the most evidence of it today on Delaware. What happens, and what Olmsted knew, is that diagram is a setting for development. He intended those parks to be surrounded by pretty valuable and desirable real estate. So that's the subtext of it. The basin is interesting. It has a couple of characteristics. First, it's on the city side, which is a big difference from being on the Outer Harbor side. Very not easy to get a lot of people out there. So how do you get people out there, and how do you eventually pay for that? I don't mind the idea of a large building on a large site, on a large body of water. So to me, the size of the stadium compared to the size of the lake and the size of the outer harbor, it's actually appropriately scaled. So I think that's a matter of design. And the opportunity to extend hundreds of acres of Olmsted-like parkland as a setting for the stadium, I think would be the backbone and the genesis of the ideas that we're talking about.
You know, we have water. That land has been sitting there for decades, and nothing was done, and no one was held accountable. But we have such an urgent need in this community, with tens of thousands of unemployed people, with young people with no future. The question is how we make the best of what we have to make some easy compromises, I think, to achieve an economic engine with the park and also structures which will be built out over 8 or 10 or more years. They're the most environmentally green and advanced on the planet, which provides additional economic generation for this economy, whether it be UV engineering or firms like Ecology and Environment. This is really the kind of project where we should all be on the same page to get to what our objectives are. We've actually started this process over 5 years ago. We looked at the Central Terminal, we looked at the Bethlehem Steel site. And you get to a point where you kind of have to take an urban planning perspective and balance all of these other issues. And we believe that HKS is one of the best firms in the world to do this. They do work with professional sports and international sports, and they work with governments, municipal and state governments. This has been their best recommendation. This land is available now. I would like to get jobs going next year, not 10 years from now. Or engage in publicly financed explorations of what could be. This again is over $1 billion in private capital. All of this will be paid for in collaboration with our city and regional and state planning departments, as well as constituent groups. I just think if we can do a public-private partnership, and quite frankly, we started this over a year ago, we went to the NFTA, when these gentlemen were just beginning the project in Minneapolis, and now they're generating thousands of jobs in Minneapolis already. We know that in Western New York, we have the proclivity to talk something to death, and that's my fear. And again, my greatest consideration is the balance between economic well-being and environmental compromise. And I think we can compromise for all and reach the objectives. There's plenty of land here. I firmly believe that this would be a better park than someone else could finance, because it would involve public budgets, it would involve finding the money, it would involve all kinds of other compromises, and it would certainly result in a delay which could take a decade or more. And this opportunity would pass. The land would still be there, as it has been for over 50, fallow and doing nothing, and not benefiting our community in a tangible way. This is what these gentlemen do. There is a complex financial formula. We have preliminary understandings in terms of a significant portion of the first $1 billion. You can't do anything until you control the land. What our group, Greater Buffalo Sports and Entertainment, has asked for is a land option that we've offered to pay for, which would simply pay the community for an amount of time for us to come back and specifically answer these types of questions on the use of the land, feasibility, parking, parkland access. But in this town, because it's publicly owned property, it's become complicated, and we're dealing with an intricate kind of bureaucratic dance. Now, thank God that the Common Council has stepped forward and said, as elected representatives, they think we should move ahead, and some other elected officials at the state level and county level have done so as well. All we're saying is we can explore this, we can put money on the table, and we can pay for this every step of the way. And once we determine it's totally feasible and acceptable to the community in a year from now, we will come back with the financing, as they have done in these other cities.
I think a very good example is what's happened in Minnesota. We, Randy and his urban design studio came up with a concept, both of a north-south park to try to tie the Mississippi River in, and also an east-west park to tie downtown. It got legs, and as we've stated, there's 1.5 million square feet of development that's moving forward very rapidly as a part of that. That's the most successful opportunity that we've had. September 2008 hit Indianapolis. So it, although it's a very proximate location, close to a central business district, as is this site, we had the recession that hit that and slowed that process down. Now that we're slowly beginning to recover from the recession, I think the Minneapolis model is very much what you might expect here. As I've said, if you build it, they will come. We think the genesis of this is highly important. Cowboys has over, in the first 2 years, had over 1 million visitors. It's equal to the Alamo in the state of Texas in terms of numbers of visitors to go through that. These are generators of a lot of footfall, a lot of activity. If it's tied in, as Randy said, with a park system, we think it could be a dynamic opportunity because of the proximity to the Central Business District. We looked at other sites. Nick asked us and George asked us to look at the Central Terminal, and it just wasn't the same site as this is. Cowboys is in an entertainment district between Dallas and Fort Worth, but it doesn't have the opportunity like the one that's happening now in Minneapolis. I think the Minnesota example may be the most aligned example of what could happen to downtown Buffalo through a project like this.
Thank you, everyone, for coming.